Many of us, including me and most of our NewsHour staff, are working from home these days, and it is far from clear how soon people can, will, or should go back to their workplace. This could have significant repercussions for workers, for companies, and for the marketplace. Paul Solman is going to explore these transformations in a two-part look, beginning tonight for our series, Making Sense.
This has worked for other things, but it's not working for you.
That's CEO Dave Kenny, our first interview for this story about working from home.
I move the mic. Yeah, I'm used to having people to do this.
That'll be a unique angle on the work from home problem.
Exactly.
The CEO of Nielsen.
Anytime you tune in or turn on.
The company famous for measuring television audience ratings, Kenny used to think working from home was a bad idea.
When I came to Nielsen at the beginning of last year, which had a work from home option, I was really quite opposed to it. The people who were in the conference room were talking to each other. Those who were working from home and phoning in or even videoing in were largely not in the conversation.
I don't mean to use this phrase lightly, but has it been for you, in a sense, a conversion experience?
It's been a big event in my life because I was forced to look at a total system change as opposed to an incremental change. I don't think I would have had the courage to go big and have everyone try this if we weren't forced to, but it did open my eyes. And it did tell me some things, if you do them big, they actually work.
And it's not just Nielsen, of course. Last week, Mark Zuckerberg told Facebook's 45,000 employees.
I think that it's quite possible that over the next 5 to 10 years, about 50% of our people could be working remotely.
Nielsen's policy?
Most people will work remotely as long as they can, allowing people to have much more of a hybrid model in the future where they're really only coming in when they need to.
But for now, the third of the U.S. workforce that can work from home is doing so, full time. Economist Nick Bloom.
So maybe a year or two from now, when firms relax and say, look, you can come back into the office if you like, you can come back in 2 or 3 days a week and spend the other couple of days at home. That's, you know, the promised land, but that's definitely not where we are now.
Now, work from home has had a surprisingly bad rap, as Bloom illustrated in a 2017 TED Talk.
If you go to Google or to Bing and you punch in working from home into image search, what do you get? A lot of pictures of basically naked people, cartoons, people juggling way too many babies to actually be doing anything constructive.
But Bloom, wanting to actually study the economic effects, found a willing partner, C-Trip, China's largest travel agency.
Here is a picture of their headquarters in Shanghai. They're interested in working from home because Shanghai is a phenomenally expensive place to run a business. Very Dilbert-esque, lots of desks and cubicles and thousands of people working, taking calls.
Two random groups of 500 workers each were studied. The results?
We found, amazingly, that the working from home employees were 13% more productive, which is huge. That's almost a day extra a week. And when we looked at the data, it turned out about a third of that was it's quieter. They said they don't get distracted. You know, my favorite anecdote was I spoke to a woman that said, you know, the person in the desk next to me, she clips her toenails. I see her leaning below the desk and I hear that clip, clip, clip. It's horrible. And then the other two thirds of the gain was actually people working from home work more hours. They also took less sick leave.
The 500 work from home employees were so much happier, in fact.
Quit rates dropped by 50%. C-Trip, they reckon they made about $2,000 more profit per person at home. They were super positive. They rolled it out to the whole firm.
And the U.S. experience mirrors C-Trip, says remote work consultant Desmond Dickerson.
Welcome to Remotopia.
Working from home himself for 5 years.
Reports show that folks are more productive and take less sick leave when they work remotely. And then a huge advantage, and I think this is going to be a game changer, is that the pool of applicants grows. Now we have folks that traditionally couldn't make it into the office. Maybe they have a disability or a chronic illness, or they're not in these places where these high-tech companies or major corporations are based. So that could be, you know, minority folks, or it could be folks that live in rural areas.
And now they have basically the same access to the types of working from home jobs that everyone else does.
No wonder then that Nick Bloom estimates working from home will increase 3- to 4-fold post-pandemic. But wait just a second. He himself, a Stanford professor, is hardly working in a remote paradise.
You can probably see I'm in a bedroom. I had a call with two different people that were working in clothes closets. I could see a shirt hanging behind somebody's ear. Kids coming in all the time.
As if on cue.
But you can bring her in. Bring her in.
You want to say hi?
Hi.
Hi. Now, what do you call your daddy? What do you call him?
Doo-doo.
Doo-doo? Yeah. No, but that's not nice.
Post-COVID, kids will be back in school, but now, I mean, I don't need to say anything else, I don't think.
As for the childless.
So you're the typical young worker who must love working from home, right?
It has its ups and downs.
Jamie Andis works for a New York real estate brokerage.
Mostly, it's difficult to find the work-life balance because it's really easy to continue to work into the night and then it's bedtime and you had no time to yourself.
Folks will burn out if they're working those additional hours.
And then there's the bugaboo most remote jobs now entail.
Meetings, meetings, meetings. That's all we do every day. It's difficult to pay attention to everybody, talk when you're supposed to talk, listen when you're supposed to listen, people talk over each other, all of that kind of stuff. So it's a lot more mentally draining than you'd think. I'm craving human contact right now, so I want to go back into the office. I want to be communicating with everybody in person.
And that might actually help her career, since work-from-homers are promoted less. For two reasons, says Nick Bloom.
One is out of sight, out of mind. They get passed over, potentially forgotten about. The second is you maybe genuinely need to be in the office to develop the kind of skills to, you know, manage people.
Skills that just aren't that easy to hone at home.
I probably should have locked the office door, I think, is the thing to do.
This is Paul Solman, working from home for the PBS NewsHour.
Cute daughter. Well, there is no doubt there's going to be a lot more working from home when all this is over, and that has implications for, among other things, the value of commercial office space. That will be Paul's next Making Sense story.